Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
There is a legend that states that after the ascension, when Jesus returned to heaven as the exalted and reigning Christ, some of the angels and the archangels and others of the heavenly host were curious about his earthly sojourn. And so they questioned him about his accomplishments. They asked, did you found a great movement? They said, did you lead a great army? How many followers did you have? To which our Lord replied, I generally attracted good crowds, but I only had 12 disciples and a few friends and dedicated followers. Well, they said, if there were so few, they must have been exceptional human beings with sterling characters, persons who were leaders in their communities and successful in their careers. To this, Jesus replied, well, actually, they were rather ordinary. A tax collector, several fishermen, just common working folk. Well, evidently, they must have been very loyal. They must have been a very loyal group, the others said. And Jesus answered, I believe they wanted to be loyal. But in my hour of crisis, one betrayed me. Another denied me, and almost all of them fled. And yet you expect this group to carry on your work, they asked. Yes, I do, Jesus said. Surely, they said, you have some alternative plan. No, said Jesus, I have no alternative plan. But you must have another group in reserve somewhere in the event that this one fails, the angel said. To which Jesus replied, I have no other group. This group is the only one that I am depending upon.
Yes.
Because this group is my church. As unstable and as unreliable as we are, as easily as we become discouraged or distracted, as quickly as we become tired and ready to give up, as often as we are inclined to complain and engage in self-pity, as stubborn as we are, and as insistent in walking in our own willful ways, as weak and as unworthy as we are, the fact remains that Christ has committed and entrusted the ongoing work of the kingdom into our hands. Any casual reading of the New Testament will reveal that our Lord left his work in some very shaky hands.
Yes, yes, yes.
It was left in the hands of disciples who demonstrated time and time and time again that they were unworthy of it and should not be trusted with it. Mm-hmm. To the very end, if you remember, Peter continued to leap before he looked. He continued to speak before he thought. To the very end, Judas maintained a secret agenda while Thomas openly voiced his skepticism. To the very end, Philip continued to ask inane questions while James and John tried to plot and politic their way to the top two spots in the kingdom. Yet these were the ones who had been entrusted with the task of proclaiming salvation to a lost and wayward world. The church that Christ left. The church that Christ left was a disappointed church. Those whom the Master called had a different conception and different expectations of his messiahship than he did. They expected him to inaugurate an earthly kingdom, and they saw themselves on earthly thrones. They had hoped that he would redeem Israel, but his teachings, coupled with Calvary, had shattered their hopes. The church that Christ left was a disappointed church. The church that Christ left was a confused church. How could Jesus allow himself to be crucified? They had seen him rebuke raging storms and cast out demons. They had seen him heal the sick and raise the dead. They knew that he could have withstood Caiaphas's vindictiveness. They knew that he could have withstood Herod's arrogance and Pilate's vacillation. They knew he could have called legions of angels to fight his battles. So why would he submit to Calvary? The church that Christ left was a confused church. Their confusion was the confusion of all the faithful when they see goodness abused and crucified at the hands of evil, or when life seems to contradict all that they believe about a just and powerful and good God. The church that Christ left was a confused church. The church that Christ left was a weakened church. Their fellowship had been decimated by divisions and betrayals and desertions and denials. None of them could be counted on when the chips were down. All of them had been shamed by their behavior on the night that Jesus was betrayed, and none of them could feel quite the same about themselves when they looked in the mirror. Their self-confidence, their perception of who and what they were had been shaken.
Yes.
The church that Christ left was a weakened church.
Yes.
The church that Christ left was a frightened church. It was a church that hid itself behind drawn shutters and closed doors. Now that Jesus had been crucified, what in the world would happen to them? Jesus had already told them that the servant was not greater than his or her master, nor the messenger greater than the sender. Jesus had already told them that if the world hated and rejected him, it would also hate and reject them. And having seen what happened to Jesus, they feared for their own lives. The church that Jesus left was a frightened church. The church that Jesus left was a lifeless church. It was a church in mourning. They had lost the physical presence of the one who was their integrating center. They had lost the one who had called them from where they were and brought them together. They had lost the one who had given them purpose in life. The church that Jesus left. The church that Christ left was all of this, to be sure. But it was more than this. The church that Christ left was also a believing church. The church that Christ left was also a hopeful church. The church that Christ left was also a trusting church and an expecting church. With all that had happened to their little group, with all of their disappointment and confusion and weakness and fear and personal loss, they still dared to believe Christ's promises.
Yes.
There were some things that Satan couldn't destroy and the world couldn't touch. There were some things they could still trust. And they could trust in Christ's promises. You know, it was said that once the great violinist Niccolo Paganini was in concert when one of the strings of his instrument broke. The crowd laughed, and he continued to play. But shortly after that, another string broke, and the crowd laughed again. And later, when the third string broke, and Paganini continued to bring forth glorious music from the one string left, the audience looked on in hushed wonder. They realized that they were indeed in the presence of a master who could bring forth sublime music from a violin with three broken strings. Beloved, the church that Christ left had three broken strings.
Yes.
But they continued to play on the one string of their faith that was left. Faith in the promises of Christ. And the Lord had promised them a comforter. He had promised them power. And they had never known Christ to be a liar. And when they thought about it, that they remembered that Jesus had told them that this time would come. He told them that he would be rejected and that he would suffer and be killed. Jesus told them that when the shepherd was stricken, the sheep would scatter. Jesus told them that they would have tribulation in this world, but to be of good cheer. For he had already overcome the world. Indeed, early on that third morning, while it was still dark, Jesus rose just as he said he would. Christ had always kept his word. Therefore, in spite of all that had happened, the disciples continued to believe. And beloved, let me pull in your driveway for a minute. Sometimes all we have to go on is our experience in trusting God's word. Sometimes life, sometimes circumstances and reality will contradict all that we believe. Sometimes we don't know what the future holds. And at times the only string we have left is our knowledge of what Jesus has done. How he has stood for us, and how he has fought our battles even when we couldn't see them, and how he has opened doors that we could not perceive. But if we can just play on that one string, if we can remember that the Lord has always kept his promises and that he has promised to be with us, it gives us reason to keep on hoping and keep trusting and praying and believing. Church that Jesus left, therefore, assembled together during the time of year when the Jews observed the festival known as the Feast of Weeks or Pentecost. Pentecost means 50 days, and it was celebrated on the 50th day after the beginning of the Jewish Passover. It was essentially an agricultural feast, where the Jews presented unto the Lord the first fruits of their labors. However, it later came to be associated with the reading of the law because it was believed that Moses received the law at Mount Sinai and delivered it to the people on the 50th day after the angel of death had passed through Egypt. Jesus had been crucified during the Passover season. He had walked among his disciples for 40 days after his resurrection, and then for 10 days, the church had gathered in an upper room to receive the promise. It had been 50 days since their Lord had been crucified, and the promise had not yet come, but they still believed. Sometimes simply to assemble together in expectation is an act of faith in itself. Coming to church this morning, assembling ourselves together is an act of faith in itself. And the question I have for you is, what have you come to this place today expecting? What have you come looking for? What do you have faith enough to receive? That thing you have been praying about and for, the question is, are you expecting it? St. Thomas, what are you expecting in the life of this church? What do you believe is possible? Thus, when the day of Pentecost had come on the 50th day, when Jews customarily assembled in the synagogue and temple to hear the law read, the Spirit baptized the church with power. On the day when the law had been lifted up, the Spirit established itself as the guiding force and the power in the life of the church. Let us never forget, beloved, that Christ not only keeps his promises, but also that his promises are perfectly timed. Sometimes, you know, we try to hurry the Lord to deliver before the proper time. Sometimes we think that the Lord has moved too late or after the proper time, but the Lord always moves on time. And his promises are always kept in perfect time. They say he might not come when you want him, but he's always on time. When the Spirit came, God's people were assembled. They were not scattered hither and yon, with one doing his or her grief thing over here, another doing his or her guilt thing over there. They were in one place. Even in a weakened church, we must never underestimate the power which can come to Christians when they assemble themselves together in the name of Jesus. No, it is said that a group of tribal chieftains were in a council, and each of them had his own plan for meeting a threatened attack. And an old and wise chief gave each a single stick and told them to break it. And each of them did so without any difficulty whatsoever. Gathering the same number of sticks again, the old chief bound them together into a bundle, and he passed it to each of the other chiefs and told them to break it. And not even the strongest was able to do so. Beloved, God gave us to each other because we need each other. There is still power in the communion of saints. There is still more power in a weak church than there is in a strong individual. Individually, no matter how strong we think we are, we can be broken. But when we come together and stay together, even when we are at our weakest, not even the gates of hell can prevail against us. Not only was the church in one place, but when the Spirit came, the church was also of one accord. It is possible for the church to assemble in a spirit of discord. When the church assembles with a contrary spirit, it can lose its identity as the church because it begins to act and talk just like everybody else. But when the church is in unity, when the church is in a spirit of love, when the church is in one accord in its spirit, it can really be church. Because then the Spirit, I believe, can flow most freely. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And then the Bible says, and suddenly. You know, we can't program or time the Holy Spirit. We can't work it up or bring it in. We can't turn it on at will and turn it off at whim. You know, we may be able to do all of that with our spirits, but not with the Holy Spirit. For the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, is like the wind. It blows where it wills, and we hear the sound of it. We are moved by its force and refreshed by its breeze, but we can't tell from whence it comes and where it goes. The Spirit goes of its own accord, suddenly, and falls where it wills. And the only thing I believe we can do is prepare ourselves. Prepare ourselves to receive it when and if it comes. Our job is to make sure that the setting is conducive to its coming and that we are real and sincere in asking the Spirit to come. On the day of Pentecost, when the church was in one place and of one accord, suddenly the Holy Spirit came. And I believe when the Spirit came, four things happened to the church. They heard, they saw, they were filled, and they spoke. They heard a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind that filled all the house where they were assembled. They looked and over the heads of everyone, they saw cloven tongues of fire. They saw fire, fires of clearing and cleansing, fires of destruction and purification, fires of melting and kindling, burning up and burning through. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And you know, I am a scientist by trade, and as a scientist, I believe in the Pauli exclusion principle. The Pauli exclusion principle basically says that two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time. Therefore, two bodies can occupy the same space at the same time. Thus, when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, I believe their disappointment had to give way to joy. I believe their confusion had to give way to clear perception. I believe their weakness had to give way to strength. Their fear had to give way to courage. Their loss had to give way to life. The Spirit gave them new life. And they spoke in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The tongues in which they spoke were gibberish, but intelligible languages. It so happened that Jerusalem was filled that day with persons from all over the world who were there to celebrate the Jewish Pentecost. And when they heard the shouts of praise from the one church on one accord in the one Spirit, they understood what was said, for they asked, "How in the world can this be? These men are all from Galilee, yet we hear them speaking in our various native tongues. We hear them in our own native language, proclaiming the mighty works of God." And when they saw meaning of it all, you know, there were those in the crowd who tried to make light of the Spirit's work by saying, you know, they just drunk. They're just drunk from drinking the new wine. And beloved, you know, there'll always be those who will not understand or appreciate or choose not to be a part of the movement of the Spirit. There will always be those who will try to throw water on the fire. But if one truly has been anointed with the fire that falls from above, God will give an answer and the Holy Spirit will give boldness to proclaim it. Yes. And so Peter stood up and said, they were not drunk. It was on 9 o'clock in the morning. It was too early to be drunk. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. He said that it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. All flesh, not just bishops and priests and deacons and evangelists, but all flesh, not just leading lay people or big names or big givers or church pillars or leading families, but all flesh, not just adults, not just children, not just the elderly, but all flesh, not just the rich, not just the educated, not just the privileged, not just the mighty, but all flesh. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions,
And your old man shall dream dreams. It shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And when Peter finished preaching under the power of the Spirit, 3,000 souls were added to the kingdom. In one day, the church increased by 3,000. The Spirit does bring life. You know, John Bunyan once saw in a vision a man throwing water on a flame of fire, and yet the flame continued to burn. And he wondered how in the world it could keep on burning until he saw that there was someone behind the door pouring oil on the flame. And I'm so glad today, beloved, that when this world tries to drown our fires, the Holy Spirit is there to keep putting oil on the flames. Sometimes I feel discouraged. Sometimes it seems like my work is in vain, but then the Holy Spirit comes and revives my soul again. And in those moments of testing and trial, I've learned to pray like the hymn writer, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Break me and melt me and mold me and fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. So I dare you, each one of you today, to cry out on this day of Pentecost, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Fall fresh on my community. Fall fresh on my home. Fall fresh on my church. Fall fresh on my guild. Fall fresh on my priest. Fall fresh on the vestry. Fall fresh on the acolytes. Fall fresh on the choir. Fall fresh on my marriage. Fall fresh on my job. Fall fresh on my mind so I can think right. Fall fresh on my heart so I can love right. Fall fresh on my mouth so I can talk right. Fall fresh on my feet so